Okay. Good morning, everybody. Is it windy enough out there for you? I was concerned it was going to blow off my toupee. Oh my gosh, it did.
It worked.
It did. Okay, let's see. What do you got here for me? 107.
Another one then.
Oh my gosh. 64 pages. Oh, give me thanks. Give thanks to the Lord, for he is good, for his mercy endures forever. Let the redeemed of the Lord say so, whom he has redeemed from the hand of the enemy and gathered out of the lands. For the east, from the east and from the west, from the north and from the south. They wandered in the wilderness in a desolate way. They found no city to dwell in, hungry and thirsty. Their soul fainted in them, and they cried out to the Lord in their trouble. And he delivered them out of their distress. And he led them forth by the right way, and they might go to a city for a dwelling place. Oh, that men would give thanks to the Lord for his goodness and for his wonderful works to the children of men. For he satisfies the longing soul and fills the hungry soul with goodness. Those who sat in darkness and in the shadow of death, bound in affliction and irons, because they rebelled against the words of God and despised the counsel of the Most High. Therefore, he brought down their heart with labor. They fell down, and there was none to help. Then they cried out to the Lord in their trouble, and he saved them out of their distress. He brought them out of the darkness and of the shadow of death and broke their chains in pieces. Oh, that men would give thanks to the Lord for his goodness and for his wonderful work to the children of men. For he has broken the gates of bronze and cut the bars of iron in two. Fools, because of their transgression, because of their iniquities, are afflicted. Their soul abhorred all manner of food, and they drew near to the gates of death. Then they cried out to the Lord in their trouble, and he saved them out of their distress. He sent his word and healed them. He delivered them from their destructions. Oh, that men would give thanks to the Lord for his goodness and for his wondrous works to the children of men. Let them sacrifice the sacrifices of thanksgiving and declare his works with rejoicing. Those who go down to the sea in ships, who do business on great waters, they see the works of the Lord and his wonders in the deep. For he commands the rises and storms and stormy wind, which lift up the waves of the sea. They mount up to the heavens. They go down again to the depths. Their souls melt because of trouble. They reel to and fro and stagger like a drunken man. And are their wits' end? Then they cried out to the Lord in their trouble, and he brings them out of their distress. He calms the storm so that the waves are still. Then they are glad because they are quiet. So he guides them to their desired haven. Oh, that men would give thanks to the Lord for his goodness and for his wonderful works to the children of men. Let them exalt him also in the assembly of the people and praise him in the company of the elders. He turns rivers into a wilderness and the water springs into dry ground. A fruitful land into a barrenness, for the wickedness of these who dwell in it. He turns the wilderness to pools of water, and dry land into water springs. There he makes the hungry dwell, and they may establish a city for the dwelling place, and sow fields and plant vineyards, that they may yield a fruitful harvest. He also blesses them, and they multiply greatly. And he does not let their cattle decrease. When they are diminished and brought low through oppression, affliction, and sorrow. He pours contempt on princes and causes them to wander in the wilderness where there is no way. Yet he sets the poor on high, far from affliction, and makes their families like a flock. The righteousness see it and rejoice, and all the iniquities stops its mouth. Whoever is wise will observe these things, and they will understand the loving kindness of the Lord. Yep. So I had a few things I was going to open up with today, and I got into a little tete-a-tete with a person whom I know on Facebook. I have never met them, but you know, they're usually pretty good in their theology. And then suddenly out of the blue, he says, baptism is not of the dispensation of grace. It works. Like, oh, okay. So there's plenty of people out there that do it. Charlie and I were talking about it yesterday, and it seems to be this new burgeoning, I don't know.
Fad.
Thank you. That's the best word for it, fad. I was going to give it a little more of a glorious description on that, but fad is the best thing to do. And they claim that it's an Old Testament kingdom gospel thing that should not be done by true Christians. And their premise is this. Jews believe throughout history that the Messiah would come and restore Israel to rule the world from Jerusalem. This belief is held by Jews today. And as we know, that day will come. But even the apostles were convinced that it was happening immediately with Jesus, even as he ascended into heaven. And this is Acts 1, verse 1 through 11. I added some to that because it's such a good thought, this whole thing. I love it. So it starts off, in my former book, Theophilus, I wrote about all that Jesus began to do and to teach until the day he was taken up to heaven, after giving instructions through the Holy Spirit to the apostles he had chosen. After his suffering, he presented himself to them and gave many convincing proofs that he was alive. He appeared to them over a period of 40 days and spoke about the kingdom of God. On one occasion, while he was eating with them, he gave them this command: "Do not leave Jerusalem, but wait for the gift of my Father promised, which you have heard me speak about. For John baptized with water, but in a few days you will be baptized with the Holy Spirit." Then they gathered around him and asked him, "Lord, are you at this time going to restore the kingdom of Israel?" And he said to them, "It is not for you to know the times or dates the Father has set by his own authority. But you will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes to you, and you will be my witness in Jerusalem and in all Judea and Samaria and to the ends of the earth." After he said this, he was taken up before their very eyes, and a cloud hid him before their sight. They were looking intently up into the sky when suddenly two men dressed in white stood beside them, men of Galilee. They said, "Why do you stand there looking up to the sky? This same Jesus who has been taken from you into heaven will come back in the same way you have seen him go into heaven." So, again, they've seen everything, they've heard everything, and they're still like, okay, well, the kingdom of Israel, it's going to happen now, right? It's like, no. So the argument today is that baptism is totally spiritual and does not involve water or immersion, and according to them, doing so is on a par with returning to the laws, rituals, festivals of the Old Testament. John the Baptist was not baptizing with the Spirit, nor were the apostles who were baptizing prior to Jesus' death and resurrection. Then to do so would be an insult to our Savior by works. So it sounds logical, right? Well, it doesn't if you read your Bible. So in Acts, which is 99% descriptive, with very little prescription for the church theology in it, as we all know, Acts describes the transfer from Jew to Gentile, from Peter to Paul. And as I read above, the Acts starts out with Jesus' resurrection, and shortly after that, the Spirit comes upon the apostles. And then to countless others. Paul is converted in his own unique way, and the unfolding of the church history begins. Peter, Paul, and others baptized with water in Acts, but you'd never get a pattern as to how or when you should baptize a believer. At times it occurs before they believe, elsewhere not at all, and then still at other times it's after they believe. So despite the lack of direction for timing, it was done. So also, Paul, who is our source of church doctrine, baptizes and speaks of baptism throughout the epistles. Ironically, the very verse that they will hang their hat on, these folks who say that you shouldn't do it, to prove that they are correct, comes from a passage, a total package, that just sinks their ship. So providing once again that context is king in the Bible when you're reading it. So this is the one verse that they'll hang their hat on. It's like, and this is Paul speaking, "I thank God that I did not baptize any of you except Crispus and Gaius." Okay. So let's start at the top, which is why he even said that in the first place. And 1 Corinthians 10, it starts, "I appeal to you, brothers and sisters, in the name of our Lord Jesus, that all of you agree with one another in a way in what you say, and that there be no divisions among you, but that you be perfectly united in mind and thought. My brothers and sisters, some of Chloe's household have informed me that there are quarrels among you. What I mean is this. One of you says, I follow Paul. Another says, I follow Apollos. Another, I follow Cephas. And still another, I follow Christ. Is Christ divided? Was Paul crucified for you? Were you baptized in the name of Paul? I thank God that I did not baptize any of you except Crispus and Gaius, so that none of you could say you were baptized in my name. Yet I also baptized the household of Stephanas. Beyond that, I don't remember if I baptized anyone else. For Christ did not send me to baptize, but to preach the gospel, not with wisdom and eloquence, lest the cross of Christ be emptied of his power." So Paul did not baptize because he thought it was wrong, or that he was returning to Jewish tradition. He avoided it so that he would not get the glory that Jesus fully deserved. But make no mistake, whatever water baptism was a part of the churches that he planted. Also, Paul warns from time to time, again, about Judaizers. You know, the ones that followed after him, trying to swing the Christian believers back into Jewish traditions, the Mosaic law, the festivals, and the old Jewish traditions, and that they would say was imperative for you to be saved and remain saved, which also, as you might have noticed, sounds a lot like the Jewish roots movement of today. Well, in all the warnings that Paul about these folks, not once does he say something resembling, "And whatever you do, don't let these people baptize you." Paul tells a list of their infractions, which includes circumcision, festivals, dietary restrictions, but never baptism. And might that be because all the true believers were already baptized, which is what really sounds logical as opposed to what they're trying to sell you? And if someone tells you that you're a poor Christian if you get baptized or question your actual salvation, just ignore them. Baptism, along with practicing the Lord's Supper, which is also maligned by these misguided folks, is pleasing to Jesus. Baptism pictures you dying with him and being resurrected with him, a new person. It's a public proclamation of your belief, and the Lord's Supper is a memorial of what Jesus did for us, which we hear every week here from Charlie. And we do this for his glory until he returns.
Which is prescripted in Paul's
book.
So.
The fad fails again. Both of these are exhortations in the New Testament. They're not commands. They just recommend very highly. So, in the event that you are truly a believer in Jesus as your Lord and Savior, and you have somehow not gotten around to getting baptized, or you haven't participated in the Lord's Supper, you'll still be saved. You're not going to lose your salvation from that. They aren't prerequisites for salvation, but they are highly recommended. Lord Jesus, thank you for this windy day, this blustery day we've got here. It's relatively dry, and we've got a full house yet again, and I'm sure a pile of people watching online. And Lord, we just pray that the sermon today be blessed through you, and may we learn that much more about you, your Son, and the unerring beauty of your Word. And Lord, just we'll certainly hear today of a lot of people that are hurting in a variety of different ways. And Lord, we just pray for them. And we pray that your healing hand and corrective hand is on them. And Lord, before even praying for that, we just pray that they know you, and they know that that you are their Savior, and good is only planned for them. And if they don't know you, Lord, may they come to know you and have the peace and comfort of that guaranteed promise. So, Lord, we just pray all this in your Son's holy name, Jesus. Amen. Yeah.